Good morning, Vandal. Today we are going to discuss briefly about perception. Before going into perception, let's try to revise what we have studied till now. First, we studied base classifiers and we have looked into that magic a posteriori property classifiers, which are also called as minimum error classifiers. We are going to get minimum classification error with the base classifier and map classifier only when you know the prior probabilities and when you know the likelihood functions properly. If you are able to estimate them very well, then that's well and good. We are going to get a minimum error classification with the help of this map rule. But we have seen the curse of dimensionality, right? It's not so easy to find class conditional distributions with the help of that limited training data we are having. It's not so easy, right? We are going to have very limited training examples with us. With the help of that limited training example, approximating joint probability density function, that's not so easy, right? It's very hard. Especially that will be hard when the number of input features are high. For example, that x bar d cross 1, suppose d equal to 1000, 10,000. That's very huge, right? The number of features are so high and each of those features can be any real value or that can take some continuous values. Let's say that x1 belongs to 0, 1, x2 belongs to 0 to 1, that continuous space, right? Then that will be very difficult to estimate that probability density function, joint probability density function. If you are having a bad estimate for your likelihood functions or the class conditional distributions, then even if you apply Bayes classifier, that may not work well, right? Because the estimated likelihood function itself is bad. You are trying to apply Bayes rule or that map rule on top of that one. Then you are going to get bad results only, right? First, you should have good estimates for prior probabilities and likelihood functions. Then only you can have better results with your Bayes classifier. Then we have discussed about nearest neighbor techniques, which can approximate arbitrarily complicated decision regions, but their error rates may be larger than Bayes error rates. Let's have a look into this example. This is nearest neighbor classifier. In general, when k equal to 1, then KNN is called as nearest neighbor classifier. This is k nearest neighbor classifier. When k equal to 1, we can straight away call it like nearest neighbor classifier. Let's assume that this blue color corresponds to class 1. Red colored samples corresponds to class 2. These are the training samples. Or these are the training examples. You can try to see. This is the perpendicular bisector between these two points. And this is the perpendicular bisector between these two points. This is the perpendicular bisector between these two points. This is the perpendicular bisector between these two points. This is the perpendicular bisector between these two points and this is the perpendicular bisector between these two points. This is the perpendicular bisector between these two points, like that. Almost you can see everywhere in the same manner. It's a nearest neighbor, right? If you want to cross check, you can consider any test sample in this entire region. That will be nearer to this sample. You can try to consider any test sample in this entire region. You can consider test sample anywhere in this region. That will be always nearer to this particular sample as compared to all other samples. This is a nearest neighbor. This is a nearest neighbor. Any test sample in this entire region is nearer to this particular sample. That's what you can have from this Voronoi cells. They are called as Voronoi cells. And then if you try to closely look into this one, this will behave like a decision boundary between class 1 and class 2. This will behave like a decision boundary between class 1 and class 2. Because suppose if your test point is somewhere here, then the nearest one is red color sample, right? When k equal to 1. Nearest one. Only one nearest one will try to see, right? Nearest one is red sample means that is class 2. When you have sample somewhere here, then the nearest one is this one. Then that will be classified as class 2. suppose you have sample somewhere here, test sample is somewhere here, and that will be nearest to this sample, then that is belongs to class 1. You can call it like this test sample belongs to class 1, right? You can try to have an intuition like that one. Then this will behave like more or less a decision boundary. It's not a linear decision boundary, right? It's a very complex non-linear decision boundary. You can try to have a look into this one. That means with the help of nearest neighbor classifier, even very complex decision boundaries also can be done, can be formed with the help of this nearest neighbor classifier. That's so easy, right? This is able to form such kind of complex decision boundaries, highly non-linear decision boundaries. But the problem with this one is, suppose, for example, due to noise or due to some mistake, this is labeled as class 2 instead of class 1 in my training sample, in my training data. Then what will happen is, this is a scenario we are going to get. In this case, any test point in this region is nearer to this red color point, right? Then this region will be classified as, any point in this region will be classified as class 2. But if you look into this closely, if you apply your intuition, most of the points are blue color in this one, class 1, from class 1. Only one point is from class 2. That might be due to noise or outlier, right? There's a problem we are going to get with this. Unnecessarily you are classifying them like class 2, any point in this region. But if you apply intuition, that might look like class 1 in this region. And after this region, that is class 2. And below this region, that is class 2. Between these two regions, that is class 1. These are the decision boundaries. Here, before this region, class 1, and after this boundary, that is class 2. In order to avoid such kind of effects, here that is very sensitive to outliers or noise, right? There's a problem with the nearest neighbor classifier, KNN when k equal to 1. In order to reduce this problem, or in order to suppress this problem, we will try to increase this k value. For example, k equal to 3 or k equal to 5. Let's consider a case where k equal to 5 and k equal to 1. Here we are having three classes, right? Red color is class 1, blue color is class 2, and green color is class 3, for example. And if you try to apply k equal to 1, KNN with k equal to 1, then these are the possible decision regions. This red colored shade corresponds to class 1, blue shade corresponds to class 2, green shade corresponds to class 3. And if you try to look into this one, this looks like very bad for you, right? Because most of the samples in this nearby region are belongs to class 3 or green color 1. But due to just two odd samples, you are trying to say that any point in this region belongs to class 2 or that blue colored class instead of green colored class. This looks bad, right? Similarly, this is looking bad for you. You can try to say this. Just because of these two red points, you are trying to say that this region might belong to class 1 or red colored class. This region may belong to class 1 or red colored class. But if you apply your intuition, as more samples belong to green color, that should be classified as a class 3 or green color class instead of red color. It looks odd for you, right? If you consider k equal to 5, such things can be avoided. If you want, you can try to look into this one. This region got nullified, right? This got merged into this green color region. Except this training point. This training point is already red. Except this training point, the surroundings will be occupied with green shade, right? That's a benefit we are going to get. In this case, these white regions corresponds to some conflict. Conflict means, for example, this is five nearest neighbor classifier. 2 out of 5 belongs to red and 2 out of 5 belongs to blue and 1 out of 5 belongs to green. If that is the case, and then majority, if you go by majority, this can be either classified as blue or this can be classified as red, because both of them are 2 and 2. We can't guess, right? One out of those two. In such scenario, we are going with this kind of white shade. You can try to have a look into this. Drawbacks of k nearest neighbor classifier. Experimentation may be required to choose suitable k value. For example, without doing experiment, I can't say whether k equal to 1 is good or whether k equal to 3 is good or whether k equal to 5 is good. That depends on your data, depends on your training data. That you need to do experimentation only. Without experiment, you can't say which one is good, which one is bad. After that, you may need to go for cross validation with your test set. And classification is time consuming if the number of reference samples are large. In this case, reference sample is nothing but training examples, as we consider in your base classifier. Because suppose if you are having 1 lakh training samples with you, now you want to test whether this particular test sample belongs to class 1 or class 2, then what you need to do in k nearest neighbor classifier is you need to find Euclidean distance to all those 1 lakh training samples or 1 lakh reference points from this test point. That many computations you need to do, right? After that, you need to find top k samples, whichever are nearer to that one. Then you go by majority. So many Euclidean distances you need to find, right? That is very time consuming process. The effect of this k nearest neighbor is this one. You can try to see this. Let's assume that this is an autonomous car, driverless car. This is some other vehicle in front of this one. For example, this is trying to make use of camera system to find whether there is an object in front of it or not. Camera followed by some algorithm in order to find whether there is an object in front of it or not. Here we are trying to go for k nearest neighbor classifier. For example, we are having 1 million training examples total. In order to, those training examples correspond to, that might be cars, that might be pedestrian, that might be cycle, that can be lorry, or that can be truck, such examples. Total, we are having 1 million such examples. 1 million means 10 lakh examples. Then what you need to do here is, you need to find the distance of this particular image. This camera will try to capture this picture in real world. In real world scenario, this will try to capture this picture, and this will try to compare this picture or this image with all those 1 million examples in your training data. Comparing means finding Euclidean distance in this k nearest neighbor case. That will try to compute Euclidean distance to all those 10 lakh training samples from this test sample or real world sample. Yes. Time consuming process, right? It will take so much of time. By that time, this might hit this vehicle, right? If this velocity is very low, this velocity is very high, this might hit this by that time, right? If that is like 1 minute duration, in order to compute all those 1 million Euclidean distances, by that time this might hit this, right? You may get good result after 1 minute, but that doesn't matter for us, right? Time matters for us. Within fraction of seconds, you need to identify whether there is an object in front of you or not. If you are unable to find, that might hit this one. It's damage, right? In order to avoid such kind of timing problems during test time or during real world application, we'll try to go for some functional form for decision boundaries. For example, I'll try to consider some linear decision boundary as follows. W0 plus W1 X1 plus and so on, WD XD equal to 0. This is the decision boundary. Suppose if I got greater than 0, I can try to say that is class 1. If I got less than 0, I can try to say that is class 2. For example, this object detection in front of us. Omega 1 means object is there in front of us. There is no object in front of us. If you got less than 0. I'll let explain once again the major difference between them, KNN and this function based method. When that is linear boundary, that's called as perceptron. For example, during a real time scenario, with the help of camera, that's capturing, that autonomous vehicle is trying to capture the images, whether some vehicle is there in front of us or not. That can be done with the help of camera followed by that KNN algorithm. Let's assume that the dimension of this image is 256x256 pixel dimension. In general, we won't blindly compare these many number of pixels with our stored pixels. We can't do this blindly, even though that is k-nearest neighbor algorithm. We can't store 10 million such images in the memory, and we can't blindly compare pixel by pixel, finding Euclidean distance to these many pixels to each of those examples. That's very hard, right? It's very hard to find. In general, we'll try to convert this into less number of features. We'll try to do feature extraction. We'll try to convert this one into x d cross 1. For example, d might be some 20 or 30. Some 25 like that, some small number. That won't be very huge number like this. 256 into 256. It's much bigger compared to this one, right? It will do feature extraction first. Let's convert this image into some set of features. For example, 20 features. Once it found 20 features, it will try to find Euclidean distance to all 1 million examples, 1 million training examples, which are already stored in the memory. Those are called as reference samples. You are trying to store all those 1 million training samples in the form of x bar vectors only. X bar 20 cross 1 vectors only. That means for all those 1 million training images also, we will try to convert them into feature vectors. Each image will be converted into 20 cross 1 feature vector, and that particular feature vector will be stored in the memory. But we'll try to store 1 million feature vectors. We'll try to compare this real-time feature vector with all those 1 million feature vectors, and we'll try to apply k-nearest neighbor algorithm. Euclidean distance followed by that one. It requires so many computations, right? But when coming to perceptron, what we are going to do is, once we extracted x bar d cross 1 vector, once we extracted x bar d cross 1, for example d equal to 20, we got all 20 features extracted from that particular real time image. Our next step will be, we'll try to substitute that into this expression. W2x2 plus and so on plus WDxD plus W0. After substituting this x bar vector into this expression, and if you got greater than 0, you can say there is an object. If you got less than 0, you can say there is no object. That's our plan. Now we can try to compare these computations with that computation. There you need to find 1 million Euclidean distances in KNN. In this case, just you can find dot product between W bar vector and X bar vector. This required very, very less time as compared to that one, right? That's the benefit of using functional form for decision boundaries. We'll try to represent that in a compact manner, right? That k-nearest neighbor can be called as lazy classifier. Why lazy classifier? Means this not learning anything from the training samples. There is no training process at all in that one, right? That k-nearest neighbor, what that is doing is simply trying to by heart all those 1 million samples, just trying to store somewhere in the memory, and whenever test sample came, they will try to search for nearest neighbors. This is not learning any structure or any pattern from the training data. It's not learning the decision boundaries, right? That k-nearest neighbor. it's not learning straight away. That's why you can call k nearest neighbor algorithm as a lazy classifier. These weights W0 to WD are to be chosen to provide good performance on the training set. That means these parameters should be learned with the help of some algorithm. There will be some training process for this perceptron, right? In order to learn this distance boundaries, well, we should represent these weights with some values, right? Some real values. That real values can be learned with the help of, for example, you can make use of these training samples or training examples, and you can try to compute mean square error with this estimation or that cross entropy followed by some variant of gradient descent algorithm in order to learn these weights. You can follow this procedure to find the weights. Once you got those weights, you can simply substitute that test feature vector into this expression. And if you got greater than 0, you can say class 1. If you got less than 0, you can say class 2. That's the benefit you are going to get with this learning decision boundaries. You may require some training time. You may require some time to train with the help of this training set for your perceptron learning algorithm. In order to learn this decision boundary, you may require some training time, right? Some time is required. But for KNN, absolutely zero time, because there is no training process at all. But during test time, that will take so much time. KNN will take so much time to say whether that is class 1 or class 2 during test time. Perceptron that can do in very short time, or any functional form of the decision boundary that can be done in the short time itself, the decision making. You can try to represent class 1 as y equal to 1, class 2 as y equal to minus 1. This is some representation. Linearly separable classes. Two classes are said to be linearly separable if there exists a hyperplane decision boundary such that W transpose X bar greater than 0 for class 1 and W transpose X bar less than 0 for class 2. In this case, W transpose, I am trying to call it like W0, W1 up to WD row vector, and X bar I am trying to call it like X0, X1 up to HD, where X0 equals to 1. That's your wish. You can follow your own notation. For two dimensional case, hyperplane is a line. Two dimensions means if I have D equal to 2, W0 plus W1 X1 plus W2 X2 greater than 0 or less than 0, then that equal to 0, W0 plus W1 X1 plus W2 X2 equal to 0, that's a line, right? It's a two dimensional case. X1 X2 is W transpose X plus W naught. Here we separated W naught from W1 W2. This notation also we can follow. Earlier I said like W bar equals to W1 W1 W2, right? Here W bar is just W1 W2, and W naught I am writing separately. See, W1 X1 plus W2 X2 plus W naught equal to 0. This is a decision boundary. Above this class 1, below this class 2. Like that you can see. These are the two features, X1, X2. And let's have a look into this. This W bar is orthogonal or perpendicular to this plane or to this line. It's a orthogonal vector to this line. It's a gradient of this, which is orthogonal to this. Thank you.